Hey everyone, welcome to Tea Talk. Today we are going to be covering the basics of preparing and enjoying tea. I received a number of requests for this topic, and it seemed like a perfect place to start the series, so this episode is going to introduce you guys to several different types of tea, and provide a brief overview of the tools and information you'll need to prepare and enjoy your own tea. So first of all, this is a tea ball, and these come in many different forms. They essentially hold your dry, loose-leaf tea and allow you to brew it in small portions such as cups or mugs. This is simply another means of doing just that. This is a tea strainer. These can be made to fit inside cups, and sometimes when you purchase a teapot, the teapot will come with one that fits inside it just like this. Another thing you're going to need is a teaspoon. These are useful for spanning fuse gaps in emergencies, but for our purposes, we're just going to be using it for portioning and stirring tea. It also helps to have something to drink the tea out of. In my case, I have my favorite teacup here. You don't need anything this fancy, though. A mug works just fine. You're also going to need some tea, of course. And in this case, I have a tin of Harney & Sons Vanilla Black Tea. You might also choose to add something like cream or sugar to your tea. I have here a couple of cubes of Demerara sugar. It's a natural light brown sugar that's named for the Dutch colony where it was originally produced. I'm not too fond of sweet tea, and I never use cream except in the case of a very particular variety of chai. But to each his own. You'll need also a teapot. And bear in mind, a teapot and a kettle are not the same thing. This is a Japanese tetsubin of modern make. It's enameled on the inside, so it really fills the function of a teapot as opposed to a kettle. We'll talk about that discrepancy a little bit later, and I've already covered it in the pilot episode. And I like to keep a clean towel on hand, just a small one, in case there are any spills or slips. These come in really handy for cleaning those up sooner rather than later. Alright, so let's get to it. Brewing tea is a very simple process, and it's made even simpler by tea bags and sachets. We're going to cover that too. But for the majority of people who are just going to be working with loose-leaf tea, all you'll need is a tin of tea and a tea strainer or a tea ball. In this case, I'm going to be using the strainer. You simply portion your tea into the strainer based upon how much water you have. You can choose more or less tea based upon whether you prefer it stronger or weaker. I like my tea strong, so I always add a little bit more than the average recommended amount. So, if you're using a tea strainer, you portion your tea into the strainer like so. And it helps to have hot water already on hand. A teapot is only used for holding water that's already been boiled. A kettle is used for actually boiling the water, which you might do over a fire, or more commonly in modern first world countries, on a stovetop. This tetsubin at the moment contains only pre-boiled water, so the water has already been heated and I'm ready to add my loose leaf tea. Ordinarily, you would pour your hot water over the top of your dry tea, but for the purpose of this demonstration, I'm adding the dry tea to the hot water in the teapot. And that being the case, I'm stirring it a little bit just to make sure that there's no tea floating on the top of the water not being steeped properly. It's important to leave a little bit of room in your teapot. Don't fill it all the way, because if you do, you risk splashes like this, or spills. So you want to leave about this much room between the level of water and the top of your teapot. And then you simply put the cover on and leave it to steep. And after usually about 5 minutes, that's the general recommended amount of time for brewing tea, you're ready to pour and enjoy. Some people like to add a couple of cubes of sugar to the teapot itself, or simply add them individually to each cup of tea. I live alone, and I only brew tea for myself. I very rarely have guests, so when I'm brewing tea, I'll usually just add a cube or two of sugar to the teapot. Man, the MLG community can keep their Doritos and Mountain Dew. This is what I'm talking about. And there you go. You're ready to enjoy a nice cup of tea. So, as I explained in the pilot episode, This setup uses a tea candle to keep the tetsubin warm. What do you do when you're ready to put the candle out? I like to use a piece of an old broken coat hanger to lift the lid off of the burner, to avoid burning my fingers, of course. And I will use this. This is just an old empty votive candle holder. I'll place this over the tea candle to snuff it, because if you just blow your tea candles out, they'll sit there and smoke and fill your room with this nasty smoky odor. This is a great way of containing the smoke, preventing any odors, and snuffing the candle nice and easily. Now, tea sold commercially is usually packaged in several different ways, and if you're just starting out, you'll probably find yourself wondering, well, wait a minute, which one of these should I buy? So here we're going to take a look at a few of the most common ways tea is packaged. In order from right to left, there's loose leaf tea, tea bags, sachets packaged in bulk, and individually wrapped sachets. Let's take a closer look at each one of these. You should purchase loose leaf tea if you're looking for maximum control over how strong your tea is and how much of it you're going to brew at any given time. Purchasing loose leaf tea in bulk is almost always the cheapest way to get it, even with high quality brands like the Harney & Sons varieties that I'm particularly fond of. I've already covered brewing tea with a strainer. Gonna just show you guys briefly how to brew it in a tea ball. Very simple and self-explanatory. You just portion out the amount of tea you want to brew, place it in your tea ball, and place that in a cup of hot water. Let it steep and you're good to go. Tea bags, on the other hand, are designed for portability, convenience, and ease of use. And if you order tea at a public dining establishment, for example, almost invariably it will be served to you in this form. Sometimes you'll also be offered a small pitcher filled with milk or cream, like this one, and a lidded jar of sugar. But you very rarely see ones like these outside of more formal tea gatherings, such as if you're invited to somebody's house for tea. Now, I wouldn't say tea bags are for casuals, but they are meant to make tea a quick and easy affair. You just unwrap them, throw them in a cup of hot water, and you're good to go. You would want to brew a tea bag in at least a large mug, maybe a small teapot. Cups this size are only meant for serving, and they would be used to hold tea that's already been brewed in a pot. Sachets are used in the same manner as tea bags, but they work a little bit differently. Whereas tea bags contain usually leftover scrap tea called fannings, sachets contain whole tea, and they're shaped this way for a very important reason. As whole tea reconstitutes, it will expand, and the idea behind a sachet is to leave the tea inside enough room to fully expand and expose its entire surface area to the water in which it's being brewed. Once again, you wouldn't use a sachet for one of these tiny serving cups. You would want at least a large mug. I prefer to brew a single sachet in a small teapot. Out of the three forms of tea we've discussed so far, I personally prefer sachets because really they give you the best of both worlds. You get the convenience of a tea bag, but the higher quality of loose leaf tea all in one. So to me, even though they're a little more expensive, sachets are more than worth it. They're a great compromise. All right, let's talk about different types of tea. Now, if you're just starting out, this can possibly be the most overwhelming part of drinking tea. There is literally a rainbow of different types of tea. There's red tea, green tea, brown tea, even blue tea. I guess black and white don't really fall under any colors of the rainbow per se, but they feature here as well. So, which should you try? Which should you start off with? We've got a small representative sampling here, so let's talk about them. This is an herbal tea. This particular one is actually made from lavender flowers, and as you might expect, it has a very floral aroma and taste. This is not one you want to overbrew because it gets bitter very quickly if you steep it for too long. When you brew it though, it does actually come out blue, has this lovely lavender color. This next one is a variety made from the peel and fruit of blood orange, and it tastes every bit as you would expect. It's got a really wonderful fruity, orangey fragrance and taste. It's quite strong, actually, and you don't have to worry about overbrewing it. And when you do brew it, it actually comes out this crazy shade of reddish orange, so it's a really neat tea. This is one I've talked about quite a bit before. In the West, it's just called chai, but it's properly known as masala chai. It originated in India, and it's made from a blend of, I think, a base of Assam, and then cardamom, cinnamon, cloves, nutmeg, and vanilla, I believe. This is what it looks like when you brew it without milk or cream, but traditionally, it is supposed to be brewed with cream, and this is the only type of tea for which I will ever use cream. That being said, I love masala chai. It's spicy and flavorful, just one of my all-time favorite teas. All right, this last one is by far the most basic of all the varieties I'm showing you guys here. This is just a simple Chinese black tea with apple and cinnamon flavoring added. Now, ordinarily, I would advise people just starting out drinking tea to stay away from flavored varieties like this because they often don't taste the way they're advertised, but Harney & Sons is actually really good about that, and the vast majority of their flavored varieties taste like what they say they taste like. Alright, let's talk green tea. Specifically, matcha. And this is something I get a lot, and I mean a lot of questions about. The thing about matcha, though, is that it's very different from most other varieties of tea, and really, it's so complicated that it's beyond the purview of this video, which is really just intended to cover the basics. For our purposes now, let me just say that matcha is made from powdered green tea leaves grown in a special way in a special place. And unlike most normal varieties of tea where you just steep the leaves in hot water, you actually mix matcha powder directly into the tea water itself. So what you get is this deep, vibrant green color of tea that actually ends up being a little bit creamy. Now, matcha is not for beginners, which is another reason it's not really appropriate to talk too much about it here. I had one viewer tell me that he tried some and he thought it tasted like very thin pea soup. And matcha is really kind of an acquired taste. This is what it looks like when it's brewed. I personally love it, but it can be very jarring to the Western palate if you're not used to it. So I'm going to talk more about that in a later episode. For the time being, though, thank you guys very much for joining me. I hope you've all enjoyed this. I've worked very hard to work out some of the issues that you guys brought up in the pilot episode. I've fixed the lighting a little bit, gotten some better lights in here, and just generally refined my method and my approach. So if anyone has any further feedback to offer, please continue to do so. I would very much appreciate any ideas you guys have that can make this series better. So thank you all for joining me, and I'll see you guys next time!